Isn't such a thing, though, Mr. Mitchum, would you say, as a typical Mitchum movie?
We open up with our hero standing, you know, straight and forthright in the middle of the stage.
How do you suppose
and suddenly behind him looms a great giant gorilla. And he hits our hero, boom, top of the head. And he hits him again. On and on and on.
Wake up!
Finally, at the end, the girl appears from stage left.
I just love you too much, Rosa.
She lifts the hero up, and he's bloody and filthy.
But you're all wet.
You better start getting used to me fresh out of the shower.
It's a film of survival. It's the story of my life.
You're going to make that film someday.
I've done it.
You've done it.
I've done it 103 times.
Off of the beach! Let's go!
In life, as in his movie roles, Robert Mitchum was a survivor. He'd known hard times, but he always bounced back, bloodied but unbowed, to complete a 40-year Hollywood career and a total of well over 100 films.
I have to tell you the story, you all know it. Only two kinds of people are going to stay on this beach. Those that are already dead and those that are going to die. Now get off your butts.
Daryl F. Zanuck, when he left 20th Century Fox as head of production, he made a picture called The Longest Day. He had every star of the Western world in it. John Wayne, Henry Fonda, Sean Connery, Robert Wagner, anybody that was hot was in that picture, including Mitchum. You know how that picture ends when you see it, The Longest Day, with all the fire and devastation on the shore and everything? It ends with Mitchum pulling out a cigar, flagging down a Jeep that a young soldier is driving, and he says,
okay, run me up the hill, son.
That's the end of the picture. Daryl Zanuck knew where his money was. It was with Mitchum.
More than a third of his films were westerns. He wore a hat and a gun in many more, but it was as a cowboy that he made his name, and some of his best and a few of his worst movies.
I remember my mother took me to see a film, it's a Western, and she prepped me. She said, now you're going to see your dad in the movie. And yeah, for some reason, it just didn't register with me. And suddenly I'm watching this movie, and there's my dad, and I scream, hey, Mom, there's Dad.
Move out of the way, Hattie. I'm going to let him have it. Marty!
Molly, I haven't got a gun. It'll be easy for you to kill me. Everybody will say you've done a very brave thing. Only when you kill a man in this country, you have a reputation to live up to. You have to keep on killing men until finally somebody kills you.
He fits into that category of the ideal American loner, cowboy, big, tough-talking, no-bullshit, straight-shooting kind of guy.
In the 1940s, the Hopalong Cassidy series was where many Hollywood greenhorns were broken in. These hugely popular films were produced by Harry Sherman, known to everyone as Pop.
Bob was hitchhiking or something, and Teddy Sherman gave Bob a lift someplace and told Pop, her father, about this wonderful, handsome fellow that she'd met who should be a big movie star and things, and Pop got in touch with him and brought him in, and that was the start of the how we got in the Hopalong Cassidy pictures. I tell you, Bob had that quality. He could have stood on the corner of Hollywood and Vine, and something would have happened for him. It would have brought him into stardom.
Mitchum took the lessons he learned to heart. He developed a passion for horses that lasted his whole life, eventually breeding champion American quarter horses on his own ranch.
I guess the first time he came up by himself. And we went and looked at the horses and so on. And as the day grew on, well, he said, well, can you get me a room at a motel? And I said, well, yeah, sure, no problem, but you're more than welcome to stay here with us. And he said, well, I don't know. I might get up in the middle of the night or something and piss in your refrigerator. And my wife looked at him and said, well, that's all right. I never had Robert Mitchum piss in my refrigerator before. From that time on, any time he came up, he stayed with us.
Robert's brother, John, was a character actor in many westerns. This was his first visit to the Mitchum Ranch since his brother's death.
Bob, of course, rode a lot of picture horses, and he did a great job in most of them, I'll tell you that.
Yeah.
But one of them he had to punch out on a hoppy movie.
When he first started his hoppy movies, they asked him, they said, do you ride? He said, oh, sure. You know, you always, when you're an actor, you always say, yeah. And then you go and try to learn how to do it before you have to show up to work.
The horse had already thrown one cowboy, and Bob got on him, and the horse threw him. So he said, now I'm going to see what this boy is made of. Bob went up and grabbed the horse's bridle and said, USOB, I need this job. It's either you or me, and he hit him a right-hand shot in the head that rolled his eyes around. He rode him pretty good after that, yeah.
When he got off the horse, they said, you know, that's really amazing. We didn't think anybody could ride that horse. The last guy who got on him, the horse killed him.
So, quite a character.
Wouldn't you like to move away from that piano, Joe?
You're darn right I would.
Well, then move!
He and John Wayne both were not ashamed of being men. You know, today you got some of these unisex so-called stars. You don't know from 20 feet whether they're men or women. Sometimes from 2 feet you don't know whether they're... But with Duke and with Mitchum, you knew he was a man and a man's man.
You ready, Cole?
Whenever you are. Let's go. Cover it. Get out of the way.
By the way, the review on that picture... They said that Brother Robert and the Duke walking down the street, one with a cane, you know, with a
crutch in one arm and one on the other, huh?
And they said actually the two of them were superior to any three actors in the business.
Yeah.
And by God, they were.
Sheriff, it looks like you're going to keep your job. Yeah, it'll be a nice quiet town after you leave, Cole.
How do you know I'm leaving?
We just don't need your kind around here.
When Mitchum was 2 years old, his father Jimmy died in an accident working on the railroad, leaving his mother Anne, who was pregnant with their third child, to bring up their young family.
His mother couldn't really care for him as well as she would like to have been able to without a man in the house. So she would pass him around to other relatives who had farms. So he got raised considering a large part of his childhood by relatives, farmers. When he was 12 years old, 1929, when the Depression hit, he packed up and hit the rails. He just figured there's one more mouth to feed. He'd go take care of himself. I think that made him independent. You know, he'd fight for survival, he had to be. And it carried with him through the rest of his life. A hobo, jumping the trains like many people did, and he got arrested for vagrancy on a Friday, I believe.
Now, on Monday morning, the judge looked down and said, I sentence you to 5 years in the state penitentiary. Bob was aghast. He said, 5 years? For what? For robbing a shoe store. Bob said, sir, when did I rob this shoe store? He said, Saturday night. Bob said, if you check your records, you'll find I've been in your jail since Friday.
There was laughter in the courthouse. This is all according to my grandfather. And so he banged the gavel down and sentenced him to 90 days on the Brown County farm, which was a chain gang.
That experience was one hard man Mitchum retold at many a Hollywood dinner table, as he did about his time as an astrologer's assistant and at sea in the Merchant Navy. Eventually, however, he was reunited with his family and they settled in Los Angeles. It was sibling rivalry with his sister Julia that drew him to the stage.
I became a member of the Long Beach Players Guild, and they were casting for a play called Rebound. And when Mom and I read it, we both agreed that the part in there, Johnny Cole, would be perfect for Bob. So we all went down to the Players Guild. And she called for readers for Johnny Cole. And nobody answered. I felt Bob freeze. And I stuck my thumb in the space between the seat and the back of his chair, and he jumped up. I struck it hard enough, so he jumped out of his seat into the hall, and I pushed him on the back. He wound up at the director's table, read for the part. He was marvelous. And that's the beginning of his theatrical career.
It wasn't long before Mitchum was snapped up by the studios, signing a 7-year contract with RKO. Westerns made his name before he made his reputation in more modern movies.
I think that he's an actor who was at his best in a genre that just came at the perfect time for him, film noir. He was perfect at the tough guy who was in a very difficult spot and was keeping his cool. Like Out of the Past is classic Mitchum material, where the situation he's getting into is crazier and crazier. He knows the woman he's in love with is betraying him. He's being played for a sucker, and yet he's going all the way to the end of the road.
Dirty double-crossing, huh?
They had him working on 3 pictures at one time, at least once. He would work all day on one, all evening on the other one, and all night long on the third one. And live on vitamin pills.
People were under contract, and when you were under contract, the studio really decided your whole life.
Like many others, he found the studio system oppressive. But Mitchum's protest was characteristically individual.
Bob said, I'm doing a picture at Metro now. I'm doing a picture here. I'm bicycling between the two pictures. Please give me a dressing room on the ground floor. And this man named Goldberg, who was the general manager of the studio, his automatic answer was no, you know, to any request. Well, about 10 minutes later, there was Bob standing in the square with a hose in one hand with soap lathered all over his body and a little tiny towel. And he had the hose going and he said, Goldberg. And Goldberg looked out of his window and said, yes. He said, do I get the dressing room or do I drop the towel? Everybody had come around when they heard Goldberg's name. And all the secretaries were saying, drop the towel, drop the towel. And Charlie Kerner, who was the head of the studio at that time, opened his window, which was next to Goldberg's office, and he said, well, let him have his dressing room, you know. And so he said, all right, Bob, you've got your dressing room. And all the secretaries said, no, we wanted to drop. Wanted him to drop the towel.
In fact, Robert Mitchum had married his teenage sweetheart, Dorothy, after his first success. And their marriage lasted for 50 years, despite the many temptations that came his way.
I don't think that there has ever been any other star who had as many leading ladies literally fall in love with him as Robert Mitchum did. Ava Gardner, Shirley MacLaine, Susan Hayward, they all went nuts about him. Duck. I mean, if you took his features one by one, his eyes were kind of droopy and sleepy. His nose was kind of a bent beak. His chin was indented, even though he had that dimple there. But somehow, you put them all together, and they spelled handsome.